Hey, it's Arroe, and this is PodFest, episode number 23. Three back-to-back conversations with real people we know through entertainment, politics, science, sports, medical, or just cooking in the kitchen. They're played back-to-back. The lyrics we share in this everyday world makes this a great place to retell their story. PodFest number 23 features one of many conversations I've had with the brilliantly talented comedian Craig Shoemaker. Then we're going to jump into a solid once-in-a-lifetime moment in music history with Noel and Delorious from the Cranberries. And we'll wrap things up with real talk about Tiger Woods from sports writer Curt Sampson. This is PodFest.
Ladies and gentlemen, his father left when he was one day old. His mother belly danced at his high school graduation party. His grandmother smokes and grows reefer. He comes from three generations of alcoholics. In high school, he was 5'1", 92 pounds, and a premature ejaculator. He's been married, divorced, and married again. It's Craig Shoemaker.
Your podcasting to your onstage performance to you being on Parks and Recreation, you are just an endless machine.
Yeah, I'd like to end that machine. I've been at it I've been doing this professionally since high school, Ava Tamini's backyard, wow, where people passed a hat around and wanted to send me to the gong show. I guess instead of gonging me, I said, let's get him out of here, send him to Los Angeles. So that's how I started, was in high school, making people laugh.
But you have taken it to such a level to where you're like that leader. You are that guy that people go, that's who I want to be.
Really?
Yeah.
I was not aware of that. I just thought of a book title this morning, 40 years and still not famous. That's so funny. So there goes my book idea. If you think I'm really a leader, people go, what do you mean he's not famous? But yeah, I've had a strange career. I've had some strange goals that have also been achieved that were unique to me. When I was a kid, I would watch Hollywood Squares with my mom, and I didn't have a dad, and I think I told you the story that she was in love with Paul Lynde. So I wrote him a letter. I said, you should meet my mother, and then you'll unconfirm as a bachelor. I tried to fix her up with Paul. Paul Lynde, oh my God. Don't think he was going to write me back. And I put her photo in there. I should have put my photo, apparently. But my dream was to be the first father and son team on Hollywood Squares.
Wow.
I'd like Craig and Paul Lynde for the win. Yeah. Take it, son. It's a sports question. Oh, my God. This one's yours, Dad. It's about ascots. So my goal was that. And then I ended up on Hollywood Squares. Kind of strange, but 75 episodes. And Whoopi would let me go into the center square and, visit. Wow. What it would have been like to be that center square with Paul Lynde being my father.
Do you walk on a set like that and look around? And it'd be like walking into a radio museum and there's Casey Kasem, there's Wolfman Jack. Do you walk into a game show set and go, there was a lot of things that have taken place before I got here?
Well, yeah, I do. I have, there's historical significance for me. And I studied television growing up. And,
really?
I majored in radio and television film at Temple University. And I just really honor the medium, and yet it doesn't honor itself anymore. I mean, when you see the shows like Honey Boo Boo,
yeah,
I didn't even know what the show was. I thought it was about a husband who made a mistake. It was Honey Made a Boo Boo. I tuned in to the show, and it turns out it might have been some sort of a mistake. But anyway, I feel bad for my kids to have to watch this crap. We had Carol Burnett and All in the Family and Mary Tyler Moore and MASH, and this is all talent. I swear, my favorite actor was Jimmy Stewart. If he was alive today, they'd put him on Jackass. Well, Johnny Knoxville, you made me staple my scrotum to my thigh. You're warped and frustrated. You made me. I can hardly walk. I mean, imagine the great actors of yesteryear, and it's such a shame, these aren't reality shows. There's nothing real about them. The Bachelor, they pick the best-looking guys on the planet. Who can relate to this? You know what they need? A regular guy. They need Swamp Bachelor. I'd watch that one. See this guy, who's your crow, daddy? You know what I mean?
But you would do Naked and Afraid, though.
I... I thought about that. You know, if they put me in a tropical environment, I'd be all right. Because, I don't want cold. Yeah. You know, even though they pixelate, you know, the Love Master's got a reputation. Yeah. And
yeah, there's a lot of pixels here, baby.
So, I wouldn't want a cold environment, you know, when the Dartosin Cream Master glands are at work, you know, and you get that, you know, button on a fur coat look that's so attractive. So I don't know what reality show. I was thinking about that now that I'm kind of giving up touring.
Why are you stopping? I mean, this is the only time I get to see you.
Yeah, well, I'm on a book tour too. You can see me on my book tour. Yeah, I got a book.
You're
gonna
come and sit. I've been on the Barnes and Noble tour. That's fun.
Yeah.
But do you stay? Are you
it's
gonna?
Different.
This is kind of a weird question, but are you the type of person that's gonna stay there and talk to everyone, or are you gonna stick to a time schedule?
I do. I talk to everyone. Yeah. It's with the bane of my existence.
That's what I've always loved about you.
Yeah, my family's like, you know, it's so bad. Plus, I'm on social network talking to people, and they can't believe that it's actually me. They always think it's like an assistant. I go, oh no, this is me. My assistant's not coming up with jokes and personal anecdotes and things like that. I mean, it's so bad with the social network. One time I'm looking on there, and it says, come to dinner, and it's from my son. Hashtag, we're waiting for you.
How's your son doing with his writing? Is he still writing a little few things here and there for you?
Yeah, he's a funny dude. All my kids are very funny, yeah. Now I have a new one, a daughter. She's not funny yet. She just smiles a lot, which is really cool. And that's also an inspiration for getting off the road.
Yeah.
Yeah, the road is very draining on, you know. I couldn't wait to be a dad. That was a big goal for me because I didn't have one. So I couldn't wait to be called daddy. And the very first word my oldest son ever called me when he was one, he looks at me and I go, oh, he's going to speak. And he calls me airport. Airport. Did you just call me airport? Something needs to change here, but it hasn't, you know. So his whole life, he's 16 now, but yeah, I want to be around and coach more Little League, even for the material. I coach, by the way, and I go out of my mind. 9-year-olds in football, and 4 of the kids have inhalers. It's like, hold, time out. And this other kid's like jealous. He goes, I want an inhaler. I go, he's got asthma. They have asthma. He's like, but I want asthma.
That's right. That's so true.
They are now with ADD. What's this attention deficit disorder? You were a kid once. Were you paying attention?
No, I'd get the hit upside the head, man.
There was nobody paying attention. You walk up to your parents. I hear every single word you say. I am focused. As a matter of fact, I have an attention surplus. What would you like me to do right now? Rewire the house? No. It was just called hyperactive. I was so hyper, I used to sleepwalk and wet my sister's bed. Yeah. And nobody gave me drugs for it. They just turned me around. There, go pee in your own bed. So raising kids in this generation is definitely giving me a lot of material, but I would like to tour a lot less with that material and find other outlets.
Does that mean a step away from Los Angeles and kind of get back into real America?
No. So, I live in an area that people think that Los Angeles is this, like, you know, big amoeba of Hollywood, but I live outside. You hear these stars. I'm going to Montana. I live in Wyoming. Yeah. Now, I live in Wyoming, but it's 40 minutes outside the city. Next
going
to a lake.
Like Oxnard and stuff?
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, I live north, and it's wonderful. You know, I coach the teams and ride my kayak and hike.
Really?
Yeah, I have exactly the life that everyone else has. It's just that I can be there for auditions.
You know who lives in Oxnard?
Who's that?
Billy Jack.
Billy Jack. Oh, the Billy Jack.
Yeah.
Is that where he lives?
I went looking for him.
Yeah,
I did.
That sounds a little stalky, Arroe. I'm afraid to even tell you the region that I live in. I'll be looking out my home and go, is that Arroe? With a microphone and headphones?
I did an interview with him, and I said, man, I'm going to be out in L.A.
No, really?
He said, stop by.
Wow.
But, man, when you get in Oxnard, it's like, you know, I'm just going to go to Santa Barbara.
Right.
I'm just going to keep going. And because there's nothing in Oxnard.
Gregory Harrison lives there, a very good friend of mine.
Really?
Do you remember him, Trapper John?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's on Reckless now.
Wow.
A show called Reckless, actually filmed in the Carolinas. He lives in Oxnard, too.
Speaking of things being filmed in the Carolinas, we are quickly becoming really the Hollywood of the East Coast.
How about that?
Do you see yourself
coming this way to do these shows? Since it has
I see myself if they ask me. Are you kidding me? Yes, I see myself. Is this some sort of a visual psychic thing you're saying? Visualize, Craig. It's the law of attraction. Tell yourself you would like to do a Hollywood movie in the Hollywood of the East. Say it, Craig. Say it four times into the mirror. I will be in Hollywood East. I will be in Hollywood East. Is that what that is? Yes, of course I would absolutely do that. I love acting. I think it's a really cool thing.
And, because it gives you a chance to step away from Craig Shoemaker, or
and have other people write the material.
But I thought
I have hours and hours of material.
Yeah, I
of
bet
comedy
you do.
Material. Hours and hours. I'm always I have it on paper. By the way, I go old school.
Do you really?
Yeah. I mean, I always think about this. Is you know, with Chargers, and you know, I'm so sick of. By the way, I want to like sue some of these companies that have different types of chargers.
Yeah.
How many chargers do you have? By the way, I have a Trio for sale. Do you remember a Trio? And I thought that was the Treo or whatever it was. I thought that was the hippest phone ever. And now try to find some complimentary charge for that thing, that charger. So that's on a stack of a big pile now. But I go out of my mind with all this. So my papers don't need a charger. I have old notebooks from college.
Wow, to be fascinating.
And I write in there with handwriting, and you know, and if I don't have spell autocorrect either, it says the wrong thing. You know, when you're trying to say, I'll come pick you up, and it says I'll call peek you or whatever. I mean, it doesn't make any sense to me, and it doesn't make us work on our minds.
Right.
And here's the thing is our minds are. So, remember, you memorize everyone's phone numbers. I knew everyone's phone number. I had really unique ways of doing that. I thought it was really cool. I used numbers of Philadelphia Eagles and Flyers and Sixers, and I would use their numbers. So I still remember like Dave Margolis or Artie Bucci. I still remember their numbers from when I was a kid based on Philadelphia Eagles from the 70s.
Right, right, right.
You
right.
know, if it was 66-88, that was, you know, I mean, I would have, you know, it was Bill Berge's number 66, and Gary Pettigrew was number 88, so I'd go, Berge Pettigrew, that's their number. Now our brains are so filled with so much crap on social network, so that takes away your brain cells. Yep. The useless stuff, their useful stuff has to leave, and everybody thinks we need to know everything about them. So now you're taking away, like, I had a guy come up, I know it's a nice custom, but he goes, hello, my name is Cade, I'll be your waiter. I go, do I have to memorize your name now? Really? You just replaced my social security number. Don't tell me the specials, I'll lose my address, my Gmail password. Please, don't fill it up with anything else. Cade, I have to remember Cade.
See, that's like going into Panera Bread now. You can just go right onto the app and order the food. I don't have to see anybody.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, you can be in the car, order the food, and then they'll just bring it right out to your table. You don't have to go to the counter. You don't have to do anything.
Oh, I like
it's
that.
It's mind-blowing.
I don't know if I like that. I like to be angry if they give me bad service. And
I thought it was two for one.
It's part of my emotional roller coaster that I'm on. I do like a human.
Right.
That's the other thing. I can't stand the automated stuff, you know, or I want to talk to somebody just with my little complainy voice and, you know, and or try to move them into a different direction to help me, actually help me, instead of, you have to write it out now.
You know, you'd be great at, or like the Taco Bell 2 o'clock in the morning boards outside, because it always goes, hi, this is Craig. Welcome to Taco Bell. And then when you get up to the window, it's Brenda. What the hell happened to Craig, you know?
I don't know about that.
Yeah, with voiceover. I'm shocked that you've never gotten into voiceover work.
You do a lot of fast food, don't you?
Look, I earned my heart attack, mister, all right?
Did you have a heart attack?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah,
my God.
5 years ago.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, that's when you realize, you know, this thing called life can go anytime now.
Yeah.
So you kind of sit back a little bit and go, I got to get more comedy in my life.
I'm with you on that. You know that. I've got a documentary we're doing about the healing powers of laughter.
Really?
Yeah. We're taking 7 people with various illnesses and disorders and things and taking them through laughter programs. I developed these laughter programs where you don't even need jokes. You just make a choice to laugh. It's called a guided laughidation. Instead of meditating, you laughidate. And in your laughter, you add you express out loud whatever your pain is, whatever your condition is, and you just throw it out there. Like, you just go, well, I'll show you real quick when I have Crohn's disease. It makes me have diarrhea at the worst times. It's incurable. So that's what we do. And we take people through these laughter programs. But in the movie, we're actually, we've heard about it many times about laughter being the best medicine, but let's see it. So we'll monitor the results with doctors and, you know, other physicians and things, blood work, heart work, you know, it oxygenates your blood, stress is relieved. We have stress tests and stuff. And so we'll see the results of what laughter does. We really need to integrate it into our system. And it's not right now. It's not. The negative is out there. It's so much so. And the reason it is, by the way, is because who are the people with money? It's not. It ain't the Comedy Zone. It ain't the Comedy Zone. You know what I mean? So it just there's the improv chains or whatever it is. The money is in corporations, right? Who create things like drugs. So they have all these drugs. They have to have, the dealers have to have customers. So how do you create a customer? You got to create a customer. And the way they do it is they scare you.
Yep.
They scare you and they put into your mind that you have these things. So now when you have an itch, wait a minute, I need something with that. I need Cialis or whatever all it is. And in the meantime, they do the side effects to cover their asses. And half of the side effects are how it could kill you. You know, I need better sleep, not a dirt nap. Thank you. You know, so, but laughter is truly the cheapest, most wonderful way to make yourself well. But they're never going to say that on television because there's no money behind it. There's a, you know, $20 cover charge to go see a comedian, or there's, you know, you can download comedy on the internet. But most people are addicted to the negative. Mm-hmm. We're conditioned that way. We're conditioned to see accidents. We're conditioned to see death and destruction. You know, I always say that, you know, it's very funny because a lot of times I can't do radio shows. They'll say, oh, the comedians, we're afraid of them. They'll say something bad because of the kids. It's always, the kids, we don't affect the kids. Really? My child, if he tuned in the news for 5 minutes, he would see beheadings, molestation, pedophilia, rape, incest, destruction, mayhem, murder, and all that. That's what he'll see on television in 5 minutes. Okay?
Yeah.
But do you really think a kid's going to be on the top of a tower with a rifle one day destroyed by Craig Shoemaker? Craig Shoemaker said F on The Tonight Show. He's destroyed me. F you all. Really? I mean, you think about that, how strange this is, how accepting we are if somebody has money behind it. My kids have to watch commercials about vaginal warts.
Oh, my God.
And I have to explain it.
Oh, no.
So you sit there with your, remember when we bonded as kids, you would go, hey, you know, this is a great show and we're having fun watching this. And my mom would explain like how Mary Tyler Moore was single and why, you know what I mean, or whatever it was. That was the extent of the conversation. But now you just watch a commercial. Hey, Daddy, Viagra, how come they're in different tubs? What are they doing in different tubs? Maybe they should be in the same tub. You wouldn't have a Viagra problem. I mean, these are the discussions I'm having with children. And, you know, we don't want to have those talks. But we like to talk about something that makes them laugh. I took my son to Vegas this past weekend, 10-year-old son. And we had an absolute blast. Took my comedy shows and magic shows. David Copperfield brought us on stage, which is really cool. You know, he didn't make my alimony payments disappear. I would have loved that if he did something with that. Or I forgot to tell you, all of my shows that I'm doing for the rest of the year are benefit shows in comedy. Whoa. And all proceeds go to my ex-wife. Oh, just I let you know. Arroe, if you guys could have seen the look on his face, oh, that's so sweet of you. You're doing a charity, and then I just got you a zinger on that comedy. But speaking of, I want to talk about my book. got my book.
You've
got
to hit the other radio show, but can you come back and talk about the book?
Sure. Well, yeah. Can we? Absolutely.
Because I want to talk about this book, because on iHeartRadio, I've got another channel called View from the Writing Instrument, which is all about authors.
Oh, my gosh.
So you got to come back for that.
We'll do.
All right, man.
Thank you, bro.
It's always a pleasure, buddy.
You got it.
If you could return, would you change anything? Don't let it burn. Don't let it fade. I'm sure I might be rude, but it's just your attitude. It's tearing me apart.
I gotta tell you, I like the remix of Linger. It really takes me deeper into the lyrics, the way that you've brought the orchestration into this.
Yes, it's nice, isn't it?
Is it part of the process of a song? They always say that a song is always continuous. It's never over. Is that what you went through? Or is it like, no, we've kind of just grown up in the industry now?
I think that we wanted to breathe some new life into the songs, and it was like coming up to the 25th anniversary of the band, and we thought it would be nice to do something special for the fans. So the idea of the quartet came when myself and Noel were doing a kind of a cameo on The Bachelorette. We were playing together and we were doing Linger, and we thought it sounded really nice. So we said, we should probably do an album like this for the fans, you know.
That is so awesome, because I was on the air when Linger first appeared on the radio, and I remember the record company sending us a box of Cranberries to go out with listeners and to do whatever we could to help push you guys forward to them.
Yes.
Because you guys were very magical when it came to promoting the music when you first appeared on the music scene. Did you get to be a part of that, or was that 100% the label's idea?
No, like, we always just kind of did our own thing, and we were very lucky with the guy that had signed us. He really believed in what we were doing and left us to our own devices. And because of that, I think that's why we kind of touched a lot of people, is that our music was genuine. It was, you know, this is what we're into, kind of take it or leave it in many ways. And because of that, there was no kind of, you know, it wasn't a big act, or it was a real thing. And that's something that we've always tried to keep going.
The Cranberries came out. It was right there as MTV was starting to kind of go away. But here came this thing called the internet. You guys got to play on both stages and had success with both.
Yeah, we've been very lucky like that. I think we were probably, you know, one of the last kind of bigger acts that actually sold albums, like physical albums, you know, because soon after that whole kind of side of the industry started to die away.
Well, even with this new mix of Linger, what I love about it is that because people have got their smartphones and their iPods and stuff, and it's become more of a one-on-one relationship and one person listening, that's what this song does. I mean, it lets you step inside.
Yes, it's got a nice intimacy to it.
First of all, I got to tell you the reason why I like Why. The opening questions were just totally drew me into the picture. Somewhere in between. Is this something that you were living when you were before you put that down on paper?
Yes, I'd written it shortly after my father passed away, probably a year and a half after he died. So having gone through that, that's such a difficult thing to go through in your life, you know. And I feel that when people die, they don't actually leave straight away. I feel that they're around still for a while, or that they're kind of in between. They don't really cross over. It takes a while to cross over to the other side, wherever they're going, you know, to the other dimension. I had a lot of weird coincidences happening all the time after he died. Stuff that made me feel like he was, you know, trying to touch base with me still, you know.
And that's what I've always loved about your music. It's so authentic. It's not like you're sitting down to read a Tiger Beat or a Teen Beat magazine. You're actually living life and sharing your journey. Is that difficult as songwriters to do that?
Well, it's very therapeutic, you know, and I've always done it that way, you know. I've always written about, like, personal experiences or things that, you know, music would reflect on something that I've gone through or I'm going through, or my own thoughts as regards to myself, you know, or how I feel. And so, I mean, I've been doing it so long that it's not something new or anything like that. It's just the way it's been, you know, and I think a lot of musicians are like that, you know.
And when you say that you've done it so long, and yet there are so many people I feel like that are still trying to copy what you guys created, because this new indie world that we've gone into because of SoundCloud and iTunes and everything, I can hear your influence on a lot of that music.
Yeah. That's imitation is a form of flattery, so that's quite flattering to hear, you know.
Noel, how was it that you guys connected to the Americans? It wasn't because it was a pop hit. What was it that you think really kind of drew us closer to you?
You know, I don't think anything else sounded like us at the time. You know, we were, especially at home, we were kind of considered an indie band. And then when we had the kind of mainstream success over here, it took us by surprise more than anybody else, I think. We didn't expect that. You know, if you could really figure out what it was that clicked, you could probably sell it to people, you know, and go, here, this is the formula. It's just one of those things. I hope that it was just that we wrote good songs, and that's what people were drawn to.
What was so fascinating about your journey is that you were able to step up there and play next to Madonna, play next to Michael Jackson, and stand out just as much as they were.
Yeah, it's just one of those kind of things that when you start out in a band, you know, you kind of don't think further than, let's just do a local gig, or, you know, we write these songs because we like them. And then it just seems like all of a sudden you're like that. You're playing these massive arenas and you're selling out tours and, you know, you're selling all these records and everything. Sometimes you kind of have to pinch yourself to see, is this actually really happening?
Speaking of those arenas, you can't put an album out like this on your 25th anniversary and not want to come out here and communicate with us through music. Are you going to do that?
Yeah, we've got we're going to be through Europe for the summer, and then I think it's kind of mid-September they're talking about for us to start touring over here. And I think in the next few days they're probably going to have those dates up.
And you know, speaking of that number 25, that happens to be that one magical number when it comes to being inducted into the Hall of Fame. Does that cross your mind at all, or is it, that's one of those crazy American things?
No, I never really thought about it.
I haven't really thought about it.
No. It's only because I heard Pearl Jam are being inducted, I think, this year.
Yeah.
That is kind of, I've heard a lot more about it in the last kind of couple of months, more so than before that.
We'll go, though, if they want us.
We're open to it. With their tanks and their bombs and their bombs and their guns.
You know what it's like when it comes to putting these albums together and you're trying new things. Did it inspire you to create another level of play to where you can get back in the game full time again? Or is this just a moment that we're documenting?
No, I think we've spoken about it, and we've always found that we write better and quicker when we're on tour. And with this tour coming up, we'd like to see how that kind of moves on from there.
Well, for the two of you, I mean, when you're on tour, if you're being creative, look at today's technology nowadays. I mean, you could have a studio right there on the bus.
Yeah, it's pretty incredible now that when we did our first albums, you know, there was so much planning that went into booking studios and getting all the gear in and everything. And these days, you know, you can kind of do so much stuff kind of at home.
Do you feel like the two of you that you're in better control of your music journey right now rather than, oh, we got to get this label, oh, we got to get this, we got to get that?
It seems like a lot easier now because it was very hectic when we were young, you know. It was like a roller coaster ride, you know, because we became so famous so quickly and we were very young. But now it feels a lot calmer, you know, and it's less hectic.
We've got less to prove as well. You know, when you're starting out, you're really, really hungry for it. So we kind of agreed to everything people would ask us to do. We were like, yeah, we'll do that. And we worked and worked until we got burnt out. So we, you know, you learn from that as well not to do it again.
It's so funny how, once again, crazy Americans love to label music and stuff. They would call it Celtic. They would call it Irish. Did you guys really try to fit into a label, or was it you're just being the Cranberries?
Yeah, I think the label that we mostly fell into was alternative rock.
Yes.
Yeah. And I thought that sounded cool.
It was that time when alternative rock was starting to move in, and they needed an artist like yourself to really cross that line to get people to come to them as well.
I think looking back at it now, you can see that we did kind of cross over from that kind of, you know, indie-ish type of scene into more mainstream. But it was just, you know, we were just doing what we do. It's kind of, it wasn't a plan or anything.
I am good, Arroe. How about you?
Fantastic. You got those golf clubs in your hand? You ready to play some golf right now?
Arroe, I was just swinging a weighted club. You caught me. I'm busted.
Hey, you got to tell me about Roaring Back. I mean, because you have got a storyline here that all of us, you know, we can watch 30 for 30 all we want, but your book takes us into a really in-depth story.
Well, thanks. This is my second Tiger book, so I've been studying this guy for quite a while. You know, we all have been, in a way. If you watch golf, you become kind of an expert in Tiger's mannerisms and his successes, really, on the golf course. Off it, it's been up and down.
He's always been that Superman, but at the same time, he's always been that tabloid hero to a lot of us.
That's true. Well, tabloid hero and tabloid villain. It was 10 years ago, almost precisely, that Tiger got in a bit of a tiff. Oh, well, let's just say what it is. A violent argument with his wife when she discovered who was texting him and why. And that was the beginning of a very severe slump or downfall for Tiger. To his credit, though, despite becoming a laughingstock, the guy came back pretty completely. It's an amazing comeback.
Well, and people are still talking about it. You know, I mean, outside of the Ruiz fight from last week, I mean, it was the greatest sports story that we had heard, was the fact that Tiger Woods won.
Moments within seconds, really, after Tiger holed the winning putt at Augusta in April, Jim Nance proclaimed it the greatest sports comeback ever. And that was part of what spurred me to write this book, or at least to a major part of its content is examining Nance's comment there and trying to weigh Tiger's redemption story with some others. I think what your listeners will have to read the book to and figure it out for themselves. But I will say this, Tiger's comeback has such a different flavor from any I've ever read about or heard about or written about. Tiger, you'll recall, he was a staple of the late night comedian's monologues in his bad old days. He was a laughingstock who came back from that. That's a substantial story.
Well, I'll tell you the one part of Tiger Woods that we didn't hear was what it was doing to his mind, body, and soul, because how can somebody take such a beating in the headlines as well as late night like he did and still remain positive? Where did he go? Was it meditation? What do you know from that side of the picture?
Part of it, a big part of it, I think, is this. One of his instructors, Hank Haney, said that the practice tee was Tiger's church. That was his sanctuary. And for a golfer, quite a good sanctuary. He could always has been able to immerse himself in practice. He loves the repetition. He loves the solitude, I'm convinced. Gosh, his dedication to the to practicing and working out, those two things, simply put, are very key to what has allowed Tiger to become a successful golfer again at age 43. He'll be 44 in a week or so.
So you've been around and you continue to be around Tiger as much as you do. So at age 44, honestly, where do you see Tiger is in his redemptive story at this point moving forward?
The medical types I've spoken with, their predictions for Tiger are dire. That he had not long ago, before this big comeback, spinal fusion surgery, and it's almost inevitable. In fact, it is inevitable that there'll be arthritis in that area and decreased flexibility. Tiger is beating that with his absolute dedication to the workout and rehab, but that's not going to last forever. Tiger is not immune to aging and the consequences of this major surgery.
What do you think hurt worse to Tiger, when his back was aching when he was out there playing the game, or the fact that we wouldn't get off his back?
Oh, that's well said. Tiger, for those of us in the media, especially the print media, he's always been a frustrating guy. More than one person has said that the only time he's boring is when his lips are moving.
Oh, God.
He's just been a cliche machine. That was training, really, from his father, Earl Woods, who considered himself a master media manipulator. His lesson to Tiger was withhold. Don't say anything, don't reveal too much, and try to use us to advantage. He doesn't fill up our pens. We've had to kind of do a write around with Tiger for all these years.
So basically, you seriously had to use what you saw as a storyteller rather than what you heard.
That's a lot of it. Yes, of course. In my first book about Tiger, called Chasing Tiger, the promised cooperation from the Woods camp disappeared just as I got the deal. It was given and then it was taken away. So here I am having to write 270 pages about a guy who suddenly won't talk to me, or will only talk to me in a group of 8 or 10 or 12 or however many by an 18th green. And the other guys on deadline want to know what Tiger hit on the 14th tee or what he thought of the greens. And I want to ask him about the role of Buddhism in his life. You can't do that. It's just, it was just frustrating.
Now, you can't bring that up in a subject and make me not want to talk about it, because that to me, that says that he did go to a place inside his head before he swung at that ball. Because, I mean, if he truly believed in Buddhism, that's living in the presence. That's being mindful of the now.
And yet I'm skeptical about Tiger and Buddhism. It only came up in that press conference and in 2010, after he'd done his 3 months in sex addiction clinic, or just before it, and when he said that the Buddhism of his mother was going to help him recover his balance after the scandal broke. But you haven't heard a word about it since. He's visited Thailand recently, where his mother is from. Not a single report of him visiting a temple. I've never heard of him and Buddhism in the same sentence or paragraph since that press conference. I'm skeptical.
One thing that's really I'm curious about, he visited Thailand, and Thailand is really known for its exotic sex escapades. So do you think, was Tiger really tempted, or did he indulge in any of these sexual experiences in Thailand?
I doubt it. I don't think so. His most recent trip was with the kids and the current girlfriend. Tiger's, the center of ground zero for Tiger's misbehavior was Las Vegas. He had friends named Barkley and Michael Jordan, who weren't exactly, they're not good guys in that sense. I just think they were bad influences. Tiger had the perfect cover, though. His rehab specialist was in Vegas, and he had his own jet and a titanium credit card. He had good reason to go to Vegas all the time. And, he was up to no good quite often.
The book we're talking about is Roaring Back. You know, I have been in more conversations with the everyday average person that, yeah, Tiger Woods, you know, he made a lot of mistakes, but I've had more people tell me, get off his back, he's only human. Do you see that side?
Well, I do. I feel sorry for him in a sense. I don't care about the money. We can put that aside. It doesn't equal happiness. Basically, this man is an introvert who, since age 14 or so, has absolutely owned a spotlight. He cannot have a restaurant meal in peace. He can't go anywhere or do anything without drawing a crowd. It must still be, to some degree, a difficult life to live for this guy.
What are you going to do, Curtis, when you get that phone call in 10 or 15 years, like a lot of these rock stars, you know, reach out to their favorite writers, and it's going to be Tiger, and he's going to say, hey, Curtis, I need a 3-day interview with you. What are you going to do? Because you write these books about him, and I know he's got to be reading them.
I think I'll have a heart attack. it's funny. Tiger, as soon as this book, Roaring Back, was announced, virtually within days, Tiger announced that he was going to be producing his second or third autobiography. Now, because he's just fed up with the incomplete and uninformed books being written about him that, of course, he won't cooperate with. So we'll see. I think self-analysis is not Tiger's strong suit, but we'll see. It would be amazing if he comes clean about his bad old days. His good days are pretty public, but the behind the scenes Tiger is, or what he thinks of himself, I hope he can tell us.
The book we're talking about is Roaring Back. Let's talk about the golf world. When Tiger was going through his strange, strong storms, they didn't need that image or that blemish on the golfing world. Did they really want him to get strong again?
Oh yes, I think so. Tiger moves the needle like nobody since probably Arnold Palmer. There would be a virtual tidal wave of support for Tiger from other players, from the industry generally. Although some of his sponsors bailed on him, a few key ones, especially the key one, Nike, did not. They kind of moved Tiger commercials to the background for a while. But now he's recovered and stronger than ever with Nike.
Inside your heart and inside, you know, your dreams for Tiger and stuff like that, do you think he'll pass Jack?
No, I don't. I think the medical part is too daunting. I think he can win again, however, at Augusta National. It's virtually a home golf course for him. He's had, I think I'm accurate, I counted the number of competitive rounds he's had there at 87, which is a lot. He the course knowledge that he has there is considerable, and it's a considerable advantage. I think even with a diminished golf swing, he can think his way around there and possibly win again.
Well, man, I'm telling you, you are affecting the future generation. You're fulfilling them, and you're also truth-filling them as well with the stories that you write about Tiger Woods. Because, you know, a couple of generations from now, people are still going to be reading your books.
Well, that's very nice of you to say. I really have the reader in mind when I write, and not my subject. Unless Tiger would announce that he was going to buy 25 or 30,000 books, then I'll write them for him.
Hey, you know, one of the things that's happening a lot lately, and that is a lot of sports writers and writers in general are getting their own podcasts. Are you putting any energy into that?
No, not yet. I'm such an oldster. Somebody always has to lead me by the hand to do anything new. I have two Gen X sons who can help me along. But no, I'm not podcasting. I'm happy to be a guest on yours, though.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
What does Tiger's life look like after golf?
You know, he started a golf course design company. I think he could get serious with that. I don't see him doing any announcing. I think he's too stiff for that. I don't know how analytical he could be. Plus, the money wouldn't attract him. I'd like to see maybe he could start paying attention to those very gaudy and over the top predictions his father had for him, in which Earl predicted that Tiger would bring the races and the nations together, that he would be an international ambassador of some sort. Maybe Tiger could step up his game in that area. But heck, that's a lot to ask, isn't it? Just as Tiger always hated to be the representative of his race, he didn't really think of himself as black in the way most people think, that is, most white Americans think the black experience is. That hasn't been Tiger.
He's always been that guy in the red shirt to how many millions of people?
He's amazing that way, a magnetic figure still. It's incredible. He's fun to write about because I don't think I've answered every question about him. I have my observations based on experience, but he is an interesting cat, that's for sure.
Well, you sure make him interesting. Please come back to this show anytime in the future, dude.
You just asked me. The questions are good. I really appreciate it, and I'd be happy to.
Excellent. You be brilliant today, okay?
Oh, that's nice of you to say. Thanks.